Good morning. Welcome. I'm Ann Fraley, the rector of St. Peter's Episcopal Church in South Windsor, Connecticut. We're delighted you have joined us this morning for this second Sunday of Easter. We begin our liturgy with a hymn, popular Easter hymn, Jesus Christ is Risen Today. We're just going to do verses 1, 2, and 4. Please join us. We are back. If you're following in the prayer book, we're on page 355 with the acclamation. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Jesus said, the first commandment is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. And now flip to page 352, or if you're in the order of service, we're down about halfway on the first page. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And we're jumping all over the place in the prayer book. We're back on page 356 for the Gloria, top of page 2 in your order of service. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We continue with the readings.
Good morning. As usual, following Easter, we read from the book of Acts, and we read about the early church being formed. I apologize, but the printed word that you have in your printed material is not from the book of Acts, but I will read you the passage so that you can hear what was done at the very beginning of Christianity. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon them all. There were no needy persons among them, for from time to time, those who owned lands or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone as he had need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
On page 787 of the prayer book, you will find Psalm 133, or at the bottom of the printed material, page 2. Psalm 133, very short. Oh, how good and pleasant it is when brethren live together in unity. It is like fine oil upon the head that runs down upon the beard of Aaron, and runs down upon the collar of his robe. It is like the dew of Hermon that falls upon the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has ordained the blessing, life forevermore. Our second reading is taken from the first letter of John. This is a teaching letter, a circular letter, meaning that it circulated among the Christian communities. And in this, John describes Jesus as both fully man and fully God, a man that they lived with, but a God for what he did and does. The word is Jesus. We don't hear his name until well into the passage, but he's being referred to from the beginning. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testified to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our next hymn is number 206. Alleluia, O sons and daughters, let us sing. We're doing all six verses because they really tell the story of the gospel passage that you're about to hear. And it felt like we'd be cheating if we left any of them out. So a little longer than usual, but I hope you'll join in. Ordinarily, I take my mask off to read the gospel and to preach, Today, however, I am afflicted with something splotchy, red, inflamed, and annoying all over my face and neck. And I don't want to subject you to that, so I'm going to keep my mask on. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Blessed are you who have seen me. You have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. It occurred to me in reading through this passage that Thomas, rather public with his doubt and disbelief, may not have been the only one among the disciples. Granted, he was the one mentioned here that wasn't present at the first occasion when Jesus decided to appear, but that doesn't mean that others didn't have their doubts. We don't really know exactly what they thought. We hear what Jesus had to say. We do not hear, nor is there any record of how the disciples responded or processed this experience. And because Thomas publicly, at least in light of being in the presence of his friends and Jesus, because he doubts, it also sort of makes a statement that this notion of resurrection, which has happened at least a week since, is slow to dawn. I talked a little bit last week about how we come to faith in our own believing over a period of time, that it's not simply, "Oh, look, the tomb is empty. Jesus must have risen." It's not that. It's more like, "What? This isn't what I expected. Who is that? What did he say? What does this mean?" When we encounter something unexpected, it's not like suddenly receiving something that is a possibility among many in our life. We don't expect to win the lottery, but if we bought a ticket, okay, if we win, it's not that big a shock. It was a possibility. The possibility of Jesus' resurrection, in spite of his prophecy related to it, is still an unexpected, out of the realm of possibility kind of event. It wasn't something that happened on a regular basis or in which anyone put any stock. It more had to do with the myths of angels and the kind of hope we hold out for, not so different from believing in unicorns in a sense. I'm not equating the resurrection to unicorns, please don't hear that. But it's more that to absorb the news of resurrection, and more than just the news, the implications of it, is something that takes time to sink in. Something that it takes time to wrestle with and see how, in a way, it plays out in our lives. So we perhaps are more like Thomas than we might want to admit. And it's also interesting that Thomas says, I need to see the nail holes. I need to see the scars, the wounds of death. He doesn't say, Jesus, if it's really you, tell me about that secret I shared that nobody else knows. Tell me about or remind me about something that only you and I shared. That will prove to me it's really you. No, Thomas wants evidence based on death. In a way, this makes sense because resurrection is about breaking free of the bonds of death. It is about leaving all of what was behind and incorporating a new reality, a new experience, a new way of being. Thomas, for all his doubt, for all that Jesus says to him, look, believe, will you? Really represents us more than we might want to admit. Perhaps we, when we go to Jesus with our prayers and with our hopes and with our disappointments, and when we need comfort, when we turn to Jesus, we don't tend to turn to the wounded Christ, but to the risen Christ. But because he was wounded, we are able to turn to him. Because he was human, because he did suffer, because he did sacrifice, all the more any resurrection we experience is going to have deeper meaning. Imagine, if you will, that Jesus is in front of you now. Are you drawn to his wounds? They might look a little gory. It's not that kind of drawing I'm thinking of. But where do we find resonance with the Christ? We tend not to put our faith and our stock and our hopes in someone who is nothing like us. We tend instead to want to find some resonance with that person that we turn to, knowing that they understand our experience or our hurts, knowing that they too have been through a difficult time and come through the other end. Who is the Jesus you turn to? Is he risen in glory? Is that the kind of marker that draws us forward in our life of faith? Is he a tired, exhausted, even dirty Jesus who's been out on the road proclaiming the word to all who would listen? Is he the Jesus who reaches out to take a hand and says, "Your faith has made you well"? Is he the Jesus who, when no one else believed, a handful of believers stuck by him, in spite of fleeing, stuck by who he was and what they believed about him to bear witness to the resurrection? Over and over again, we are privy to different facets of Jesus. This risen Jesus is the one who says, look at my hands where there are holes. Look at my side where there's a scar. If I can overcome this, imagine what is in store for you. That is the Jesus of faith, of resurrection, of transformation, Other facets of Jesus are also real. And yet in this Easter season, what we come to terms with is the reality of resurrection. We know it in our heads, we've known of it all our faithful lives. And yet at this time of year, we get to come to grips with the very real, very present reality of his resurrection. The wounded Christ is the one who rises. The wounded Christ is the one who returns to God. The wounded Christ is the one there waiting for us to say, Lord, I believe. Whatever doubt may stand in the way for you this day, perhaps there's none, but if there is any, put it into the hands, the wounded hands of Christ. Trust it in his presence to be transformed and redeemed, and to lead you by those very hands into a new way of living and loving and believing in God Almighty, who has raised this Son from the dead. In that belief, we stake our claim as followers of the risen Christ. And in that reality, we say hallelujah and amen. Will you please turn now to page 358 in the prayer book, or page 4 in your order of service, and join me in reciting the words of our faith written as the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue with the prayers of the people, Form 3.
The prayers are on page 387 of the prayer book, or page 5 of the printed material. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for our bishops, Michael, Ian, and Laura, Nigerian bishops, John and Marcus, and our rector, Anne. Pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. We pray for the departed, especially P.V.K. Achan, and the more than 563,000 people in the United States, and the more than 2.9 million people worldwide who have died of the coronavirus. Give to all the departed, eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. We pray for those afflicted with the coronavirus, including Susanna and Becca, their families and communities, for frontline workers and essential employees, for healthcare workers and professionals, especially Tara, Robin, Paul, Mark, Adrian, Cindy, Kim, Charisse, Gina, Jen, Lorraine, Kyle, Brian, Carrie, Michael, Megan, Amanda, Saud, Brian, Melanie, Laura, Ken, Sharon, Dave, Austin, Tim, Franny, Ryan, and Tammy, and for their families, for nursing homes, staff, and residents, for all people and communities impacted by efforts to slow the spread of this disease. For these and all in need of God's comfort and peace, we pray. We ask your prayers for Priscilla Snow, Elsie Ergo, Tim B., Brett, Carrie, and Valerie, as well as those committed to our ongoing prayers. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, including our families, friends, and neighbors, for the concerns and organizations supported by St. Peter's through mission, especially Episcopal Relief and Development. For others, we lift up in prayer, either silently or aloud. We ask your prayers for members of our armed forces serving at home and abroad, and for their families, especially Kenneth Fraley Jr., Kevin Merrill, Jason Sara, Jason Dorval, and Ryan Waite, and for victims of natural disasters and human violence throughout the world, especially those who have been victims of recent gun violence, for persons and communities impacted by centuries of anti-Black bias, and for others seeking to undo the harm of racism. For groups to whom we extend hospitality through the use of our building, especially Boy Scout Troop 62. In our parish cycle of prayer, we give thanks for the blessings of life in Christ, for the ministry of lectors and intercessors, for parish members, the Van Neel family, the Waite family, and Heather Waite, for Leslie Roulier and Isabella Lundy, who are celebrating birthdays this week. For what else are we thankful?
Almighty God, you made us in your image and call us to share in the renewal of this world. Inspire us to seek and serve Christ in all persons, that the proclamation of your good news in our worship, in our words, and in our work may lead us into the fullness of your love. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our next hymn is from the songbook, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. The words are embedded in the order of service. We sing it through twice.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Please join me in reciting the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And join me in reciting the prayer that follows. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness. And in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom, who with the triune God lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. Now go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Tend the sick, honor all people, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of God's Holy Spirit, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Thank you for joining us today. Thanks to Tim for playing, for Dora Lee for being here to read and pray. And I hope you have a wonderful day and good week ahead.